Come on, put your hands together and praise the Lord this morning. For He is holy and good in everything that is good within us. Let's continue praising the Lord together.
When we walk with
to
was borrowed for 3 days. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the Others may claim that title, but you and you alone are Lord, and we worship you in spirit and truth. We proclaim you are risen from the dead, and you are Lord. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he Lord, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Sing it again to him this morning.
He is Lord, he is Lord. He has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
We're going to be in Romans chapter 12. I was supposed to start a series today. And I'm not going to be able to do that. The Lord sent me in a different direction at the last minute, kind of. Not really last minute, but earlier in the week. So we're going to push that series back to next week. And you'll be excited. Next week, we're going to be starting a series on Joshua. On Joshua. And I am really excited about it. And so the Lord gave me that months ago. Not all of it, but He gave me that series months ago, and I had planned in February to kind of start it off. But we're going to be doing a Joshua series and talking about courage and bravery and all that. So we'll be doing that next week. So you can go ahead and start reading the book of Joshua if you want to and get ahead. But today I'm going to call an audible, if you will, and I'm going to, well, it is Super Bowl Sunday, isn't it? So I can call an audible. I didn't even know that fit, and it fit. And so I'm going to call an audible today and follow the Lord's leading and share with you something that no doubt the Holy Spirit has given me this week. Yesterday, we were here, many of us, along with a lot of our friends and family, and we celebrated the life of Gail Medina, one of our members here. In the last 2 weeks, we've lost two very vital and key members of our congregation, sadly. But they both are in much better places and in much better conditions than they left this world. And so for that, we are thankful. But it's not like we don't feel the sorrow and we don't feel the pain. And it is difficult. It's very difficult when a church and a body of believers, we talk about membership and membership Sunday and joining a church. And we do that because we are part of a family. And when we lose someone and it's part of our family, it hurts, right? And so yesterday, I felt the Lord this week giving me this sermon. And yesterday, it became very obvious as we took part in this service for Gail. And we even at the end heard people share about how good she was and how much good she did. She did a lot of good. Many times we see this in our lives and we see people do good for us. And maybe we're even the ones that are the givers of good. I hope you are in many cases. I love to be the recipient of good. Can I get an amen? I mean, come on, who doesn't like good? Just last Sunday, we had a board meeting after church, and we provided lunch for the board members and their families and our district superintendent and his family. We got the meal catered. We were able to have a meal catered, and Philip didn't have to cook for us, and it was such a blessing for him. You know, that's what assistant pastors do. They provide meals, yeah. He didn't have to cook, so we had it catered in. So I contacted a friend of mine that I've gotten connected to through the Chamber of Commerce, and his name is Greg, and he owns Greg's Restaurant in Chickamauga. And he just started another restaurant up in Rising Fawn. So Greg kept telling me when he would see me, you need to let me come cater something at your church anytime y'all have a luncheon or something. So I finally gave him a shot. So I contacted the restaurant. He wasn't there that day, and I talked to some lady I'd never met, and I thought I knew all of them there. I don't go that often. Quit judging me. But I contacted someone. They said, "Yeah, we'll be glad to do this." And so I was expecting it to be like $150 or so to feed 17, 18 people, 20 people, whatever. It's somewhere around there. And the lady told me, she said, "Well, I'll text you the amount so you can have a check waiting on us." Perfect. I never got a text. And I thought, well, you're not getting paid. So I walked out of church and I went over for our meeting and our luncheon together. And Mitzi came up to me and I said, "Is everything here?" She said, "Yeah, you're good to go." I said, "What about the invoice?" She said, "Greg said it's on the house." So I contacted Greg this week and I text Greg and I said, "Greg, my friend, you didn't have to do this." And he responded to me with some greetings and all, and he said to me something powerful. He said, "It just felt right." It just felt right. This week, I showed up in my office, and I looked in my box, and I found this. And everybody that has a box in that office, all the leaders that have a box, they had one in there. I think I know where it came from, but I'm not certain, but I think I do. And if I see anybody has put their name on a box that's not supposed to be there, I'm going to have a problem with it. But I don't know who did this, but somebody put Snickers in all of our boxes. Why? Because it probably just felt right. And I love when people do good. You walked in this morning and you got a couple of packs of M&Ms, to your surprise. It wasn't just mints today in a bulletin. It was M&Ms. And I hope that it made you feel good. Because why? I just wanted to do good. It just felt right to give you some M&Ms today to make you smile on this beautiful Sunday. These are just examples of doing good. But the question is, why do we do good? Why did Gail, one who had very little, and that's no secret, it was spoken of yesterday, Gail had very little to give resourcefully, financially, materially, but yet she did so much good. I'm not preaching a sermon on Gail today. You're going to see where we're going, and it's going to be in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Verse 13. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Boy, those are pretty direct words from our friend Paul. May God add his blessing to his word this morning. Here Paul is writing to the Christians in Rome, and he gives them a good explanation of what love must be. Love must be sincere. That's how we opened up the text. Love must be sincere. Now, I try to make it a habit to tell you I love you. I tell my kids that. I tell my wife that. I tell people I love that. I tell you all that. As a matter of fact, every Sunday at the end of the service, almost every week, unless I forget, I tell you, I love you, but Jesus loves you. See, y'all been listening. And I hope you find the sincerity in it. I hope you don't think I'm just repeating myself every week. I really, really love you. But let's just agree on something. Nothing says love like showing it. Right? I love when people tell me they love me. I told you of Joanne, some of her, I think her last words to me before she passed away a couple weeks ago was, I love you. And that meant so much to me. It hit me right here, and I knew she sincerely meant it. But if you really want someone to know how much you love them, Paul says, show them. Show them. Practice hospitality. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Telling God we love him is not sufficient enough. The Lord loves to hear us tell him that. Our love for God can be expressed and should be expressed in our words to him and our attitudes and feelings from our heart towards him. But our love for God has to be lived out through our relationships among one another and in a very real and tangible way. You want to know how much someone loves the Lord? You see how much they show love to others. I believe that's a measuring tool for us. Yesterday, this place was packed out. We had to put chairs in the lobby for enough people, for people to be able to sit down. I mean, people were shoulder to shoulder. It was hot as fire. I was the one wearing the tie and the suit, so. And all that was said about how great of a person Gail was and how much good she did, I told somebody this morning, I said, we could have came in here and just sat. And just the number of people that showed up would have been enough to express how much Gail really meant. Just the response of people coming showed just how much good she did for others. We didn't have to say it. Our actions spoke for themselves because we showed up and packed the place out. And that testified of all the good that she did. You see, to love God means that we love others, and loving others means we reach out to them in real ways. And it's all of this that formed the foundation for what John Wesley called a rule. And John Wesley's rule was do good. It was one of three rules he had, and that was one of them. Do good, he said. Doing good takes God's love for us and our sincere love for him to the next level. And we use that love to help others. Doing good puts God's love into action. Doing good is loving our neighbor as ourselves. And the Bible is full of passages that support and affirm that teaching. It's not just John Wesley's idea. He gets that from text. For example, in 1 John chapter 3, Paul says, this is how we know. Look at this on the screen. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Verse 17, if anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. Paul makes it very clear right here that the love that we share needs to be extended in real, tangible ways. That could even be a hug. That's sharing love. So it's clear that the foundation of the Christian faith is to love others, and loving others means doing good for them. Do good. Love for God has to be turned into loving actions toward others. And John Wesley understood this as well as anybody. About a year ago, almost a year ago exactly, I look back, I put a saying in our bulletin. Because it really means a lot to me. I didn't preach on it or anything. I just put it in there to encourage. Well, today it's back in your bulletin again. And it's the words of John Wesley, and it reads this. Listen really good to this. Do all the good we can, by all the means we can, in all the ways we can, in all the places we can, at all the times we can, to all the people we can, as long as ever we can. This statement begins to answer some of our questions about doing good. If we were to ask ourselves, who should we do good for? Well, John Wesley tells us, for everyone. For all the people you can. If we were to ask ourselves, where should we do good? Should we just do good at church? No, for anybody. Do good for anybody that you can. We do good in all places. Do we do good by just giving our money? No. You give of your time, your talent, your resources, anything you have available to you. You do good by giving that to someone else and doing it in a loving way. What Wesley is saying is that the call to love others is extensive, and there's no limit to the love that we are to show others as God has given us that love. We do all the good we can at all times and at all the places and by all the means and for all who are in our lives. And if you're like me, sometimes you begin to question that statement. You can easily question what John Wesley has told us here. The Apostle Paul gives us clear instructions that loving is best showed by doing. Love in action. God's love in action. If the Lord loves you and his love is in you, then you will go and do good for others. You will go and show that love to others by meeting their needs. So sometimes you question yourself, well, what does that look like? If you're like me, you want a list. I love a good list to go by. Wouldn't it be nice if the pastor just came in here and said, okay, here's five things that you need to do this year, and you and the Lord will be just A-okay. At the end of the year, he's going to look at you and say, you have done good. No. There's not a list. Giving somebody a Snickers bar is not going to be on that list. Paying for somebody's meal is not going to be on that list. Giving someone a hug, making that phone call, praying for someone you've never met, that's not just going to be on that list. Here's the list. Make it a lifestyle. Doing good should be a lifestyle. It should be all that you think about and all that you want to do. It's not just about a list. Yes, there are things that Jesus tells us in his word. He tells us to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to visit those who are sick and imprisoned. But I don't think Jesus ever wanted us to limit ourselves to just those things. I believe Jesus wanted us to make doing good a way of life. And if anyone's ever done good to you in an unconventional way, then you will agree with me really easily. I told this story before in a sermon. When my wife's brother unexpectedly passed away a few years ago, some of the greatest good that was done for us as a family was when some close friends of ours showed up, kidnapped our kids, and hijacked our vehicle, stole our car, and said, hey, we're going to take your kids for the day. Y'all got too much going on. And they took our kids, and they took them to the park, and they played with them, and they occupied them, and they took them to restaurants, and they gave them ice cream and just spoiled them like grandparents. And then they took our car to the car wash, and they cleaned our car inside and out, had it shiny and looking good, and they brought it back full of gas. That's not on the list. But it was the best good that could have been done for us at that moment. Nobody told them to do that. It wasn't in God's word that said, hey, go grab their kids. But those people make it a way of life. They didn't think twice about it. It just came naturally. It just happened. When we follow God's commandments and are obedient to His word, we allow our hearts and lives to be shaped and guided by His love. A love that turns into a love for others. Many times we can ask ourselves, what does it look like? What does it look like to give? What does it look like to do good? What good should I do this week? If you're living in the Lord's love and allowing His Holy Spirit to lead you and guide you every single day, you're going to know the how, when, what, where, why, and who when it happens. It won't be any question. It'll be up to you then to be obedient. You will know when to do good.